Bring in Texas Congressman and member of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, Michael Burgess. Congressman, it's good to see you this morning. Thanks very much for joining us.
Good morning, Maria. Good to be with you.
Your thoughts on these devastating wildfires right now and the impact?
Well, you know, your hearts go out to the people in Southern California who are affected. And I pray that that mandatory evacuation order is taken seriously. This is not something that you can stay and fight with a water hose. You have to get out. If the order is a mandatory evacuation, please leave.
Congressman, let me get your take on the divided Congress now, back in session tomorrow for the first time since the midterms. We know that this week is going to be about the leadership races. Kevin McCarthy on the Republican side is going to be minority leader, likely, and many people expecting Nancy Pelosi to be the Speaker of the House on the Democratic side. Is that what you're expecting?
I think what you've described is an accurate assessment of the field ahead of us.
What will you and your colleagues be able to get done in the next 7 weeks before the House flips?
Well, as you know, we have to get the there was a partial funding of the federal government last September 30th, but there's a continuing resolution out there as well, and the big one there is Homeland Security, and the president wants a wall. And many of us feel that he should have the money he needs for border security. And my expectation is that's likely to be one of the first skirmishes that you'll see in this divided government before the Republicans relinquish power. It likely will devolve from that after we get into the next session.
So Kevin McCarthy,
it will be a fight over Homeland Security.
Exactly. Kevin McCarthy this weekend said he's focused on these two appropriations bills, one to get that money. Do you think you'll have the votes on the border wall funding? I mean, you had the votes in the House. Yeah.
Yes, he'll have the votes in the House. I hope the Senate can call themselves together and get this done. The problem there is the 60-vote majority, and then how much do the Republicans in the Senate have to give away in order to get what they need done for funding the Department of Homeland Security? But it's critical. We all know that it is, and you know, we've talked about this before. Part of my goal too is on the foreign operations funding. Let's stop sending money to governments in Central America that aren't doing a good job for taking care of their citizens. If that money needs to be redirected, reprogrammed to USAID or other nonprofits, let's do that rather than continuing to fund governments that are only allowing and encouraging their citizens to leave.
Yeah, and the president has said that as well. What's your take on divided government in 2019? The president will put out his budget, obviously, in January, and then the Congress will react. What can get done in 2019?
Well, a lot can get done. You know, I was in Congress the last 2 years of the George W. Bush administration. There, the House and the Senate had both gone to the Democrats. The president was still the president. And it became tougher going for the president. But at the same time, if Republicans hold together in the House, certainly we can sustain any presidential veto. And I would encourage the president to think seriously about vetoing a spending bill that is not to his liking. And I think you'll have the votes on the House side to sustain that veto. Now, may not be necessary because we got to see what the arithmetic is over in the Senate, but it looks like it will at least be no worse than it is today, which is narrowly divided, but at the same time, yeah. Republicans holding a majority.
Yeah, I want to ask you if there are any plans for any spending cuts at all in any of these bills, but let me talk to you about the tax cuts, because Kevin McCarthy, the current majority leader, and Rhode Island Congressman John Cicilline, who is looking to be in the leadership in the new Congress. He's vying for assistant Democrat in the leadership in 2019. They both joined me this weekend. We'll start with Kevin McCarthy. Watch this.
We will look to make sure we continue to make our military strong, make sure that we can combat China and others and their aggressive actions. And also when it comes to trade expanding, we want to find places that we can find common ground. But those places that we principally disagree with, we will stand up strongly to show America the difference, to make sure that we can continue to grow this country.
The fact is that tax cut gave 83% of that tax cut to the top 1%, to the richest people in this country. And now the Republicans are proposing we pay pay for that by cutting Medicare and Social Security. We can't do that. We've got to protect Social Security and Medicare. We need a tax cut for middle-class families, not 83% of it going to the top 1% richest people in this country and the most powerful corporations.
Well, I've got to push back on that because 80% of the tax cut plan did not go to the top 1%. As you know, Congressman, the tax cut plan lowered all income levels and they doubled the standard deduction. So
Maria, that's
point,
just not true.
No, it is true.
Maria, that's just not true.
Maybe you get there because the corporate rate was cut. Are you saying you want to have
That's right.
So you want the corporate rate at 35%?
Well, so you acknowledge it's right that 83% does go to the top 1%.
Congressman, do you want to raise the corporate tax rate? Is that what you're saying?
Well, I don't. What I say we have to do is we have to be responsible about that.
Look, I understand that you want to keep with this talking point that is inaccurate. That's fine.
No,
you can do
fact.
As you will.
But the
question is, what are you going to do on taxes? Are you looking to raise taxes? Are you looking to reverse the economic policies of this president?
No, what I think we need to do is give a real tax cut to working families, to middle-class families. That's permanent and longstanding, not giving 83% of it to the top 1%.
That sounds like what's being worked on right now, tax cuts 2.0. Do you think tax cuts 2.0 go away, or do you think that's actually a reality for this Congress, the new Congress?
We've already had that vote in the House of Representatives, and the Senate really should look at that very seriously because it will be harder in the next Congress to provide the permanency for the middle class, and yet that's what we all say that we want to do. You know, if there was a... It would have perhaps been better to provide that doubling of the standard deduction and make that retroactive to January 1st, 2017, going into an election year. In retrospect, that might have been a better trajectory. But look, the last thing you want to do is tell the middle class that, you're facing a tax hike in 2026 because we couldn't get our work done.
Right.
That just won't fly.
And by the way, according to the Tax Foundation, the top 1% pay 40% of all federal income tax. And the top 10%, which is those households making more than $133,000 a year, they pay 71% of all tax from the Tax Foundation. Mitch Rochelle reminded me of this weekend, and I want to make sure to, because this talking point keeps coming up. Go back to the border wall for a moment, Congressman, funding the border wall. Negotiations are expected to stretch into December. As we learn about the migrant caravan passing through Central America, it's grown to more than 6,500 people. So what do you think happens here with the border wall funding? Because it doesn't look like the Senate is on board with this.
Well, they need to get on board, and they need to come aboard pretty quickly because the window of opportunity may be closing as one Congress leaves and the next one convenes. With the difficulties that we're facing on the southern border, it's hard to believe that every single member of the House and Senate is not focused on how do we provide the president the tools to provide the border security that we know we all need. The president has had to send, 15,000 troops down to the border. I'm grateful that he did that, but at the same time, there has to be more permanency to that security.
All right, we will leave it there. Congressman, it's good to see you this morning. Thanks so much.
Good deal. Thank you.
Congressman Michael Burgess.